I'm fired up about this show right now.
I'm just saying, send it to your mama. She cares. Oh,
wow. I love Adam's face, though. When we tell him he's right.
You got schooled.
I did.
Oh. Whoa!
That was tailor-made for Overreaction Monday.
They got a tough schedule, but they're back. But I don't really know. No, they're back. They're going to win the division.
Win the division?
That's the
what Monday you know is what? A problem.
Well, there you go. Just another day at the office. Well,
hype it up.
It was pretty. That's fair. But the Jaguars live to play another day after Sunday's wildcard win over the Bills. Blake Bortles did more with his legs than his arms. Then he just turned it over to that Jacksonville defense. Enough for the Jags to survive and advance to face the Steelers next weekend. So, we're Overreaction Monday. That's a good place to start. Here we go. Here's the statement. Bortles better off running than throwing. Overreaction or not an overreaction?
Listen, this is not an overreaction. If you watched this game yesterday, they tried to give Blake Bortles easy throws. There were crossers. There were screens. There were checkdowns. And he couldn't complete passes. And when he started to run, they actually moved the ball. He should be the backup running back, not the starting quarterback in Jacksonville. He should be the guy that they put in the game when Leonard Fournette gets tired. Definitely should be the dude that's throwing the ball for this team.
Listen, he joins a pretty elite company as a guy to throw more, I mean, run more than throw more in a playoff game, but, you know.
Look, like we were talking about Drew Brees, and we said that when Drew throws it, he throws it where he wants it to go. When Blake throws it, literally, I'm telling you, just watch his body language after he throws it. He does not know where it's going. He doesn't know. I'm telling you, it just happens that way. And in all seriousness, he's a guy who right now will be the demise of this football team as far as how far they go in the playoffs if he ever has to get to a point where they put it on his shoulders because they have to throw it. That's why this team has to play with a very specific formula. The defense has to absolutely just snuff out opposing offenses. The special teams can't have any ball fielding blunders. They have to make sure they keep the field position in their favor. And Leonard Fournette in this running game has to be going because if they have to throw, they're flat out in trouble. Simple as that.
Doesn't look like he's throwing with a lot of confidence.
No, he's not at all.
Because he doesn't know where it's going.
Exactly. It's strange to watch him actually sometimes. I'm telling you, when you watch him throw it, just watch him after he releases it. It's almost like, man, I don't know where that thing's going to wind up. And it happens often. It happened a lot yesterday. Now, I'll see it.
Lewis said it, I think it was when they played the Texans. And you were like, for the first week, he actually threw the ball with some conviction. And we've seen him go backwards from that point. When you go to San Francisco, when you play in Tennessee, we've seen Blake Bortles regress as he's gotten throughout the playoffs or through the regular season. They can't beat the Pittsburgh Steelers if Blake Bortles plays this way.
Here's what they need. They need the Blake Bortles from December that at one point was as hot, if you can believe this, as any quarterback in football. Had 8 touchdown passes, 0 interceptions, was playing on top of his game. And then somehow those last 2 games seemed to dent that confidence. It carried over into yesterday. And if you're a Jaguars fan, I think you're hoping that the victory, even though it was in the lowest scoring wildcard game in NFL history, is enough to buoy him up. The fact that they've had success in Pittsburgh will buoy him up and will somehow enable him to perform better than he has the last few
years. I've been through this. Remember, in Washington, we had defenses like this in the mid-2000s.
Absolutely.
Where we could absolutely just, like, totally blank offenses. Special teams were capable of keeping field position in our favor. But the offense at some point has to do something. And it just wears on the rest of your team.
Absolutely.
They have to be better than this.
Listen, they said.
Certainly against the Pittsburgh Steelers.
That's right.
They set offense back like centuries yesterday watching this game. I was sitting in my room and I couldn't believe how bad it looked.
It wasn't
watching
electric.
These two
it electric was not electric. Electric is not the term.
Not the word they live to fight another day, another week.
That's right. Yep.
So.
How about this tweet from Jaguars.com? Jaguars quarterback A.J. Bouye on Steelers quarterback Ben Roethlisberger recently saying he wanted to play the Jaguars in the playoffs. This is what he wanted. This is what he's going to get. Well, that's true. Jaguars take on the Steelers Sunday at 11 o'clock. And listen, if they play the way they did yesterday, I don't blame Ben Roethlisberger one bit.
Hey, if you're Ben Roethlisberger, you understand what this defense was able to do, though. They had 2 pick six, 5 interceptions, and Ben Roethlisberger, this was the game he was questioning if he still even had it after this game. So he said he wanted this. He said he wanted to prove to himself and also the Jacksonville Jaguars that's not who he is. But when you watch this defense play yesterday, they were on point.
They play with a crazy level of confidence.
Mm-hmm.
And, swagger, whatever you want to call it. These guys believe that one-on-one, they can just absolutely blank your offense.
Yeah.
They just believe it. From Jalen to A.J. Bouye to the safeties to Miles Jack to Talbot. All of these guys believe you're not good enough to beat us. And that goes such a long way. And I believe AJ when he says, this is what you want.
Think
this
about,
is what you're going to get.
This, Lou.
And that kid has earned every dollar he has been paid.
Think about
every
this,
dollar.
For Jalen Ramsey to make the play that he did at the end of that game, to be ready to jump the play, but also have the confidence to jump it at that time, it talks to what you're saying about being confident and thinking that you can't be beat.
And can I say this to Jaguar Nation, finally, just once and for all? Look, Jalen Ramsey is fantastic. He's fantastic, okay? A kid that big, that long, that rangy, should not be able to move as quick as he does. I didn't think he would be able to handle short area quickness the way he does. He's proven me wrong one gazillion times, and the kid is fantastic. So, Jaguar Nation, please. Can you please give my mentions a break? The guy is fantastic. He is a shutdown.
That's a red flag.
Lewis has said, don't at him.
Don't at him.
He's fantastic, and I'll tell you what, I wish I had 1/16th of what Jalen can do athletically. He's fantastic. He's fantastic.
Who is this guy?
No, I know. I'm impressed with his mea culpa.
You know what? I mean, the people act like I said the guy was like a free agent or something. He's fantastic. But you know what? It's like, hey,
What did you say?
A guy who's this tall. A guy this tall, this long, may have some problems with guys who are like AB, who are very quick, shifty. Jalen has proven that, look, it doesn't matter. He's a big guy. Jalen looks like, if you remember Mike Haynes, the old Raider player.
Yeah. Hall of Fame?
Exactly, which is exactly where this kid is headed if he keeps playing like this.
Wow.
Listen.
Because he's unique. There's nobody like him. There's just nobody like him in the NFL
right now. He came here before his draft, I was trying to convince him that if he had to play nickel and safety, it would be okay.
Right.
But I was like, man, listen, I was like, you can be a Pro Bowler if you do the Malcolm Jenkins thing.
Yeah.
This guy is the premier outside corner.
Not necessary.
Right now.
He is a bigger Mike Haynes prototype. Is what he is.
That's the highest
compliment I can give him. Simple as that.
Stay on my boy Mitch's, bro.
And he's got that confidence.
Oh, absolutely.
You know what? He's got that
swagger. To the point where I sit there and I go, I mean, he's just telling people, you're soft. You're getting nothing.
I think it's hilarious. I told him he was weak. And he was.
I mean, it's ridiculous. I mean, that's what I'm saying. That is what's going to carry this football team. That right there may be enough. For Blake, I don't know where it's going, Bortles.
No.
Lewis,
it's not enough.
We'll see.
It's terrible.
We'll see.
Chris Berman's left in Hawaii. Blake, I don't know where it's going, Bortles.
We'll see.
I'm sorry. Wendy Nate, this show is off the rails.
No, it's not. I will let Lewis have a floor.
I told you I have a lot on my mind today.
Yeah, I know. We're just getting started. Luckily, we have a lot of time.
I feel like I'm hot, and these studios are usually cold, and I'm hot right now.
You and me both.
Uh-huh.
All right, so. There was another team on the field, perhaps, believe it or not, in this non-scoring affair. Tyrod Taylor, as we continue with Overreaction Monday. Tyrod Taylor has played his last game for the Bills. Ryan, I'll go to you. Is this an overreaction or not an overreaction?
I think it's an overreaction because who are they going to go to? A lot of times when you want to replace a quarterback, when you want to replace a coach, you have to say who else is left. And we saw Peterman. He's played a half and a series, and he has 6 interceptions. So you definitely can't go to that guy. So to me, you have to really look at your team. If you're Sean McDermott and say, okay, can we get a better guy? And if you can't, I think you have to go back with Tyrod because he was at least able to get you in the playoffs after, a 17-year drought that this team had.
Sean McDermott, Brandon Bean came in, and they got rid of Sammy Watkins, and they got rid of Ronald Darby, and they got rid of Marcel Darius, and they got rid of anybody that they felt like they needed to. They tried to get rid of Tyrod Taylor already. They benched
him. That's my point, though, Adam.
Hold on.
Yeah.
They also have double ones in the first round of the draft. They also have a $6 million roster bonus, option bonus payment due on Tyrod Taylor in March. That something tells me that for a player that you're willing to bench, you're not going to go pay $6 million in an option bonus payment for. Now, again, they may look out there, but it's hard to imagine in a year where there never have been so many quarterbacks available via free agency in the draft that this is the guy that they're going to invest their money into.
I know what you're saying. Look, until you find the next best alternative, you better be careful and all. But, look, yesterday was the ultimate example of confirmation bias for the Buffalo Bills. They were like, we've been looking for you want to know why we were trying to get rid of Tyrod? Because of the play yesterday. And you're right. They have enough assets now to where they will get somebody. They will play with somebody. I just don't see how they'll play with him next year. You know what? As a matter of fact, I think there's a quarterback in Kansas City. I'll bet. They would be pretty interested.
Yeah. Now that makes sense.
That won't be their quarterback next year.
Alex Smith to the Bills.
Mm-hmm. Didn't Buffalo deal with Kansas City so Kansas City can move up and take Patrick Mahomes?
Didn't they deal on second-round linebacker?
Hey, this is Sean McDermott, Brett Veach, the GM, Andy Reid. They all used to work together in Philadelphia. I was there. Yes, maybe be working something out.
Is Bill Belichick answering to a Giants reporter one word? Absolutely.
So he's not going to coach the Giants?
Apparently, everybody always does what they say, Adam Schefter. You know that.
He's not going to coach the Giants.
So
I'm sure you probably have told us that already, Adam.
More NFL Live straight ahead.
Discover Car. We treat you like you treat you.
Well, the divisional round matchups are set. Saturday's slate kicks off with Eagles, Falcons, and Philly. New England hosts Tennessee in primetime later that night on Sunday. Two games as well. Pittsburgh looking for some revenge from a poor Week 5 showing against Jacksonville. And following that, Vikings, Saints in Minnesota. We continue, though, with Overreaction Monday. We know L.A., the second youngest team in the NFL, led by Sean McVay, who became the youngest coach in either the NFL or the AFL to reach the playoffs. So here's the statement. Playoff inexperience caught up with the Rams. Is that an overreaction?
Yes, it is. It's an overreaction. Look, they just didn't play well. I don't think this had anything to do with playoff inexperience. When you have punt muffs, you don't field the ball cleanly, that isn't because of playoff inexperience. That's because you just aren't executing the way you've been executing all year long that puts you in the Pro Bowl. When you're a Pro Bowl type of returner, catch the football. Mm-hmm. Don't fumble it.
Yep.
When you're a guy like Sammy Watkins, as good as you're supposed to be, as high as you were drafted, when Jared Goff puts the ball in your hands, catch it. Make the catch. When you're in the end zone and you're having contested catch situations and DBs are bodying you up, you have to come up with hard plays. Mm-hmm. Your college teammate DeAndre Hopkins, he makes those 50-50 ball catches all the time. They just didn't make the plays and give the Falcons credit. Yep. They came out.
I think you have to do that.
In the secondary in particular, they came out and took the fight to the Rams offense.
Absolutely.
They tackled tremendously. We talked about that on Countdown, remember? Mm-hmm.
We went back to those fundamentals.
That's right.
That you said would make a difference in this game.
And the Falcons executed to a T across the board.
Yeah, I believe it's an overreaction as well. I think this is more about what the Falcons were able to do. You look at Matt Ryan, how efficient he was. Steve Sarkisian getting to the run and making sure they stuck with it. I thought the Falcons just outplayed the LA Rams and made the plays they needed to, and the Rams just didn't.
Adam, overreaction to say that it was playoff inexperience that did the Rams in?
Well, it's an overreaction, but listen, I go back to the previous week when the Rams had clinched their standing and they rested the regulars, the key people. And the one thing that you've seen this league, it's very easy. If they had won, we would have forgotten it. But they didn't win, and so you look back at it and you wonder what's going on. But again, it's hard to regain that momentum that they lost. And not only that, but that week, they said right away, they didn't hide their intentions. They said, we're going to rest our key people.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there are coaches out there, veteran coaches, who would say that even if you're not going to play your key people, don't let them know that you're not going to play your key people until the game starts.
Because
that's an interesting point, yeah.
For the week of practice.
Right, it does. That's true.
And so I think everything changed for the Rams. Again, they had a great season. And I think what happened Saturday night was surprising. And I don't think it was because of inexperience. I think it was more about not making plays. But I think this whole process, they had an experience going through it. It's a learning process for them. They'll be better prepared for it in the future.
Either way, you learn from it.
Yeah, and if you watch Sean McVay after the game, he spoke to that, though, that it wasn't about the experience and that they will learn from this and be better next year.
That's how it works. Now on to the Chiefs. After blowing an 18-point lead to the Titans, lots of question marks as to quarterback Alex Smith's future in Kansas City. We alluded to that earlier. So here it is. Alex Smith has played his last game for the Chiefs. Adam, overreaction? Not an overreaction.
Not an overreaction, I think, in this particular case. I think, look, we know that they went out and drafted Patrick Mahomes for a reason. We know that they came up short again in the postseason. We know that they're ready to turn it over to Patrick Mahomes. I think it's logical to deduce that at some point this offseason, somebody's going to give them enough to make them want to part ways with Alex Smith.
They are flat out fired up to see Patrick Mahomes play.
Yeah.
It's that simple. I can tell you that. Confirmed. Alex Smith will play elsewhere.
Absolutely. This is not an overreaction. This team has been preparing for this. When you go and get Patrick Mahomes at the place you draft him, you know that he is your future. And we've seen the ceiling with Alex Smith. You know, you go back to the Colts game a few years ago when he actually played very well in the playoffs and they still lost. This team doesn't believe Alex Smith is the guy to get them to their Super Bowl aspirations. It's time to move on to a big arm quarterback like Patrick Mahomes. and we will see Patrick Mahomes starting for this team next year, not Alex Smith.
I think it's time to say, though, thank you, Alex Smith. You have to appreciate what he did in Kansas City and how well he played at times. To your point, we have seen the ceiling.
He was great.
But he was great.
He would look very good, the Buffalo Bill on his helmet.
Listen, I feel like we're just getting...
He's still going to play football.
Either with that
Alex Smith still has football
left.
In the division.
I'm just saying that. I didn't say where.
He would look good in the
But he looked good with that.
Yeah, he fits there.
Yeah. That's fair.
I don't think Kansas City's going to trade him there.
Yeah, that's
true. I mean, it would be smart.
I don't think they're going to go Drew Bledsoe and do that.
We've seen that movie before. Let's talk about Mike Mularkey for just a minute, if you will. Obviously, his team's in the playoffs. Now they'll keep playing, as a matter of fact. But there's still been questions about him to his job status. Now the team coming out and sort of giving him a
The controlling owner came out over the weekend and said... He-